Good morning, Heidelberg Union Church.
Good morning.
Good to see all of you here this morning. Whether you have been here all your life, or you are here for the very first time, or you're worshiping with us virtually, we are glad that you are here to worship God with us this morning. A few announcements. Porch Fellowship will not be on the porch after worship today. Because of the heat, we will be in Fellowship Hall. So you are invited to join us for some snacks and some drinks in the Fellowship Hall after worship today. There is a sign-up sheet in the back. If you would like to host one of our Porch Fellowship times, please make sure to look at that and see if the weeks you're available are open. Water vials are available at both entrances to bring your water back from your sacred spaces, your vacations, your home, wherever is sacred to you. We will bring those back on September 8th, and we will bless them, and we will boil the water and get it ready for our baptisms and our anointings through the year. VBS is coming up next week already, July 22nd it starts, so please spread the word to everyone. We have lots of kids registered already, so we're looking forward to that week. And thank you to all the volunteers that have said they would help with VBS. What a great ministry that is. Some people news. Barb continues to be on hospice care, so we ask that you continue to pray for her. She will be moving to a new location, and if you would like to know where she is, please speak with me. On July 28th, we are having a potluck luncheon that is a VBS closing worship. So if you would like to bring something, a covered dish, a casserole, something sweet to share, there is a sign-up sheet in the narthex porch entrance. Are there any other announcements for the good of the body? All right, if not, let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship by listening to our prelude.
Thank you.
No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Who are we as Christ's church? Together, our vision is welcoming, embracing, giving, celebrating. Together, our mission is no matter who you are, we welcome everyone into our Heidelberg family, embrace the diversity of all people and their ideas, share our time, talents, and treasures with our community, and celebrate each other all through God's love. May the peace of Christ be with you. Let us get up and greet one another in Christian love. Please remain standing in mind, body, or spirit, and join me in our call to worship. God comes, so don't let go of all of the reasons to rejoice. We will sing a song to the one who fills our lives with joy. God comes, so don't stop lifting your prayers with thanksgiving. We will sing a song to the one who hears our words and silence. God comes, so don't stop giving your hearts to God. We will sing a song to the one who graces us with a peace we cannot begin to understand. Our opening hymn is It Is Well, Red Hymnal 785, or on the screen.
Thank you.
Colleen says she's sorry. we think we're back on track up there now. Please be seated. Now is the time for us to share the things we're not so proud of with our God, our sins, our regrets, and our wrongdoings, first in silence. And now joining our voices together in the prayer of transformation and new life. Refuge of our hearts, we have not made you the center of our lives. We look for shelter in the false security of the world, not in your promises. Our fears are driven by our emotions and decisions, not by our trust in you. We look to the powerful, the beautiful, the athletic, to be our role models instead of the one who comes in your name. Have mercy upon us, our light and our hope, and touch us with your forgiving grace. Fill our hearts with your presence. May your mercy and grace be upon us, we pray. Amen. Our God is a God of love, of grace, and of mercy, and our God wants a right relationship with us. Through the power of the Holy Spirit and Jesus Christ, we are a forgiven people, sent out to do better. Thanks be to God for a love like that.
Good morning. The first scripture reading is from Psalm 46, and it's a responsive reading. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth will change, through the mountains shake in the heart of the sea. Though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult, Selah. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be moved. God will help it when the morning dawns. The nations are in uproar. The kingdoms totter. He utters his voice. The earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. Come, behold the works of the Lord. See what desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations. I am exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. The second reading comes from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.
Children's chat, but as you know, over the summer I've been letting the kids sit where they are, and this has been a message for all ages, for all of us, since we have some guest speakers speaking. So it's my time to talk with you all. So my question for you this morning is, do you worry? Is there anybody that doesn't worry? Ever? You don't worry ever? I see someone pointing to you, but you're not raising your hand. So that could be Carol's interpretation that you don't worry. Maybe you worry in silence. Anybody like that, worry in silence? Don't tell anybody you're worried, but you worry kind of on your own? Yeah. What helps you when you are worried? What are some things that help you get through that worry?
Prayer.
Anything else?
A cup of tea.
A cup of tea? Getting little tasks done. Get your mind off of it.
Staying busy.
Staying busy. Yeah. Go visit someone that might be struggling. Yep. Anything else? Anybody a journaler? Write it down. Yeah. Yeah, me too. I'm a journaler. Yeah. So we talked about prayer, right? Prayer is a response. That was the biggest response from all of you, was when you're worried, you pray. So let's talk about prayer for a little bit. What is prayer? How do we pray? All different ways, right? Right? What are some of the ways that you pray? You pray with words, maybe? Yep, first in Thanksgiving and then prayer requests.
I pray for the other person that I'm having the problem with because they feel it's prideful and pray for yourself. So
okay.
I pray that God would bring them to me for forgiveness versus.
Okay, so when you're struggling with a relationship, you pray for the other person as opposed to praying for yourself. What else? Exactly.
Thank you, Lord, for that part that missed us, you know.
Yep, simple words. Yep. Do we need to use words to pray? No, right? Sometimes our best prayers are the prayers that we have in silence, in the silence of our hearts, when we don't have the words. Do we have to have the words to pray? Do you have to have the words to pray?
No.
God knows, right? It's biblical. God knows what is on our hearts and what's on our minds. So even when we don't have the words, God knows. Why is prayer so helpful, do you think? Why is it so helpful to pray? Keep us focused on God. Does God always answer our prayers the way that we want our prayers answered?
No.
Right. And we're going to hear today from Kelly about Relay for Life. We're going to hear about cancer research and development and education. Cancer is something that we don't have a complete cure for yet, right? So it's something that a lot of people deal with. How many people have someone in their family that, and you might be saying this, so I'm sorry if I'm jumping the gun, but how many people have been touched by cancer in some way, shape, or form? Yeah. I don't know if you're aware, but my dad's going through cancer treatments right now. So he had prostate cancer, he had kidney cancer, those are both under control, and he's still going through treatments for bladder cancer, all relinked to Agent Orange. From Vietnam, from when he served in Vietnam. Two of my aunts passed away with cancer. My grandmother died of cancer. My mother-in-law died of cancer. And I'm sure you all probably have a similar list of people that have been affected by cancer. So there is not necessarily answered prayers the way we want them when cancer is a diagnosis. So why is prayer important? If we're not going to get what we want, if we're not going to get necessarily the healing the way we want it, because I feel that even death can be healing. So if we're not going to get the answer that we want, why pray? Why pray at all?
There's an answer there somewhere. We just might not see it.
Yeah, we might not see it, right?
We'll see it later.
Right? I feel like prayer connects us with God, but it also connects us with one another. When we know we're being prayed over, those people that are on our prayer chain, when they know that, when they know that their community is praying for them, it gives them strength. It gives them courage, right? So it's important that we pray because we're praying in community. We're praying for and with one another and with God. So let us pray together and repeat after me. Dear God,
thank you
for prayer
that comes in so many different ways.
And thank you
for listening to us
and for guiding us
and for being there with us
in all of life's challenges.
And all God's people say,
amen.
Good morning. All right, today I would like to share my passion and work with Relay for Life. So the first thing people most think when I say Relay for Life is that running must be involved. So first, let me assure you, there is no running at our events unless you include me running around to grab something I forgot for one of our ceremonies. Relay for Life is an organization that raises money for the American Cancer Society. I have been working with the Relay for Life of Kutztown and Eastern Berks for almost 20 years now. The event started in 1997, and I first learned about it in 2005. The summer before I was to start high school, my friend and soccer teammate lost her sister to cancer. Her sister would have been a senior in high school and was less than a month away from turning 18. She was a star athlete, and her mom was also my soccer coach. I remember the day it happened because I was taking a test at school to determine if I could skip ahead in math. I remember the guidance secretary coming in to me to tell the news while I was taking the test. She was a relative of the family, so she heard the news as soon as it happened. I remember her asking me if I wanted to finish the test later. Being in shock and numb, I just decided to finish the test. I did not pass that test. In the days and weeks that followed, I didn't know what to say or how to help my friend feel better. Then she told me she was joining the Relay for Life team at our school. Being a runner, I was all in for joining her, only to find out there was no running involved. Instead, I found an event that celebrated survivors, remembered loved ones lost, and worked to raise money so that one day no one would have to hear the words, "You have cancer." I found a place for people to grieve together and celebrate together. An event that was trying to make the words, "You have cancer," a little less scary. Relay is an event that pulls people together from throughout the community for one cause, to find a cure for cancer. Our event has transformed over the years from a 24-hour event to a 10-hour event, but the feeling has never changed. We raise money for the American Cancer Society throughout the year through fundraisers, and then we come together in May for our event. At the event, we have ceremonies honoring our survivors, remembering those lost, and fighting back against cancer. In between ceremonies, we walk around the track, eat good food, listen to music, participate in activities, enter a lot of raffles, but most importantly, we make connections. I was a team member throughout high school, raising money and walking around the track at the event each year. My favorite part of those 24-hour events was walking the track in the early morning when there was barely enough light to see. The only sounds were nature and some quiet music. There was a very spiritual feel to that time of the morning, like God was telling me that I was right where I was supposed to be. Then came graduation, which meant I was no longer a part of the high school team. I felt a little lost because I didn't want to lose my new friends or walk away from the great things that were going on at Relay for Life of Kutztown. Then came a little divine intervention. In the early fall after graduation, I was attending Kutztown University. I received an email from someone named Amy Miller about needing help planning and organizing the event. I had just graduated with an Amy Miller and assumed it was my friend from high school. I agreed to meet at the diner just outside of Kutztown to discuss where I would fit in as a volunteer for Relay. I was surprised when a different Amy Miller sat down at the table with me, but I stayed. We talked, and I decided to sign on as the Luminaria chair. I was responsible for managing and organizing the luminaries purchased in memory of loved ones lost or in honor of those who had won their battles. The conversation was the beginning of a long-lasting relationship. I later learned that my role also required me to be in charge of the ceremony for Luminaria. While I was in school to be a teacher, I was terrified of speaking in front of people. Many of my high school teachers actually questioned if I would ever become a teacher. However, the first year I stood up there, something changed. I was still nervous and quiet because I didn't know how close I needed to be to the mic, but I felt empowered. Once again, it was like God was telling me I was exactly where I was supposed to be. Afterward, some people came up and thanked me for the ceremony. At that moment, I realized just how important my role was. I continued my role as Luminaria chair throughout college, striving each year to make the ceremony a little better. When the change came to our leadership structure, I took over all of the ceremonies. While the Luminaria ceremony still holds a special place in my heart, the survivor ceremony is now equally important to me after meeting several cancer survivors and unfortunately seeing some of them pass on. I feel it is my duty to celebrate them as though this may be their last event, because for some of them, it will be. This past year, we actually had two high school or college students who had never met before at our survivor ceremony. One was a survivor, and one was singing because she had lost her aunt to cancer. They actually formed a friendship that day and are still talking to each other. So we love our survivor ceremonies where we can make connections like that. Today I am still our ceremonies chair. Even when my schedule was crazy, including the year that I had a toddler at home, was writing my dissertation, and had a baby on the way, I felt a calling to stay. Family and friends told me I was crazy, but I knew in my heart that I could never walk away from Relay for Life, because it is now part of who I am. Relay and I have been through a lot together, but the mission never changes to work toward a day that no one hears the words, "You have cancer." We have been through hurricane-like storms, running around in the downpours, trying to save luminaria bags. We decided to start laminating them after that year. We have been through the heat that made it almost impossible to continue walking. We have been through venue changes due to construction. We have been through the pandemic, where we held a drive-through event to make sure our survivors knew that we were still thinking about them, and that those who had lost someone to cancer could still come and mourn. Many events did not survive the pandemic, but ours did. Not only did we survive, but we have expanded from the Relay for Life of Kutztown to the Relay for Life of Kutztown and Eastern Berks. We survive because we are spirit-led. Our largest teams are from local churches, and each of us on the leadership team has a personal and spiritual reason for volunteering. Now, a few years post-pandemic, we are back to our pre-pandemic numbers, and we are growing. We have a new location and a new name, but the vision that has existed since 1997 stays the same. We will be out there every May until the day that no one hears the words, "You have cancer." Now I want to give you a little taste of what our ceremonies are like at Relay by reading an excerpt from one of my ceremonies from a few years ago. The question most frequently asked of American Cancer Society volunteers, of Relayers, is, why do you do this event every year? And you look at that person and realize they don't get it. You wonder if there is any way to explain how Relay changes people's lives. How do you explain the story of the newly diagnosed cancer patient who attends a Relay and meets another cancer survivor who has had the exact same disease and is still alive? How do you explain the story of a caregiver who has traveled down the path of compassion, love, joy, sorrow, guilt, loss, and depression? Explain how at Relay, a caregiver can talk to the only other person who could possibly understand this difficult journey, another caregiver. How do you explain the story of a friend or coworker who has seen someone they know battle this deadly disease and can do so very little to help? Yes, they could take the person to treatments or mow their yard or bring them dinner, but it isn't enough. Yet at Relay, you can form a team, raise money, educate people on cancer, and fight back against a disease that takes too much. All of these people have found at Relay what I have found: hope. You can feel it at 3 a.m. when you walk around a Relay. Wandering across the damp grass, mist in the air, you can almost touch the energy in the air. That energy is hope. The combined power of hundreds, thousands of people coming together in common cause to eradicate a disease. The American Cancer Society Relay for Life is held to remember those we have lost to cancer, to support those who are battling the disease, and to work towards the day that no one has to hear the words, "You have cancer." Thank you, and I hope you'll consider joining us this May.
I think that was prayer turned into action, don't you? Prayer can turn into action. When we're in relationship with one another and we see a need, it helps us to act on that need and to live spirit-fueled lives. And Kelly, you are living a spirit-fueled life. So thank you for all of the work that you do for Relay for Life. And I hope that maybe we can have a team one day. Wouldn't that be nice? I think that would be very nice. It would be great to go out and to support you and the rest of the people out there that are supporting this cause. In Psalm 46, There's one line that I always hang on to when I don't know what to pray. Anybody take a gander at what that is? Be still and know that I am God. When you don't have the words, when you don't know what to say, just remember that. Be still and know that I am God. And God is with us. Amen? Amen. Amen.
Holy One, as we reflect on your word, we have questions. Was Puccini's music for his ears alone, or was Starry Night only for Van Gogh's eyes, or discerners of spirits better than those who prophesy? Is it better to be a healer than a preacher? Was Mother Teresa more important than the Jesuit brother who held the door? This summer, we are reminded that all gifts are from the same Spirit. They are each a part of the whole and given to each of us for each other or for the common good. Lord, help us understand. Thank you for all gifts. Help us to use our gifts for the common good, serving you and our community. Strengthen those who feel faint. Give courage to those who fear and bring wholeness to those in need, especially Ed and Don, Arlene, Cynthia, Pat, Mercedes, John, Fletcher, Tim, Matt, Linda, Millie, Jean, our country, Zayden, David, Todd, Sarah, Melanie, Danica, Denise, Jim, Brian, Stuart, Jack, and Pat. For those on the prayer chain, we keep in our prayers, and for those that were not mentioned in our hearts. We also pray for our weekly partner in ministry, the Northeastern Synod of the Evangelical Lutheran Church this week. Bless them as they continue serving Christ in the community and beyond. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus Christ with the prayer he taught us to say, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Now is a time for us to give back some of the many gifts that we have first received. It is now time for our tithes and our offerings. we dedicate these offerings in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm going to share with you a prayer that's in the book. I just love this book by Kate Bowler. It's called Good Enough. It's 40 devotionals. It's great for Lent. You never know, we might do a series on this sometime over Lent. She has also written a book called Everything Happens for a Reason, All the Other Lies I've Been Told to Believe. And she has herself battled with cancer. So I would highly recommend, if you're struggling in any way, looking up her podcast called Everything Happens. I know it's really helped a lot of people to listen to her words. So let us be in an attitude of prayer. Oh God, comfortable would we be if you gave us formulas and answered prayers and realized hope. But you call us beyond comfort. But God, life upends us. We face divorce or miscarriages, financial struggles or job insecurity, and the people we love are tossed about by disease or loneliness or homelessness or addiction. We are afraid. We don't have adequate answers, and sometimes we can't find you. Or we can't find the person we hoped you would be. May we learn to trust that you aren't asleep on the job, that you haven't forgotten us, that you are as near to us as our very breath. Give us the courage to press on, to suffer with hope that you have overcome the world. May again and again we be awed by your presence, that even when we feel like we've hit rock bottom, may we recognize we have fallen into your arms, because there is no place so deep or so dark or so scary that your presence cannot reach. In the name of the one who stills the sea with mere words, amen. Go from this place. Be still and know that God is with you. Amen.